The events of the last week should serve to remind us and to reinforce in us an abiding, reassuring truth. We are all part of a heavenly family. We have a heavenly Father, and our heavenly Father is still in control.
Man.
What an awesome God we serve. He has afforded Merv the blessing of long life. He has blessed each one of us in like manner. Truth is, not just Merv, but all of us have a lot to be thankful for. So with those brief thoughts in mind, I invite you to relax in the spirit of thanksgiving and in the spirit of praise as we celebrate the very special birthday today of one Mervyn G. Williams. So the first order of business on such a special occasion is for us to invite God's presence in our midst. In light of all that's gone on this week, I believe that it's providential that our opening prayer tonight is going to be given by Chaplain Barry Black.
Whoa.
He serves as the 62nd chaplain of the United States Senate. Please bow your heads as Chaplain Black leads us in a prayer tonight.
A bunch of folks.
I want to hear Barry first.
I don't know if you can hear me. It says the host can see and hear me. But
we can't see you.
I can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
If everyone's able to mute their line, that would really help with the background noise.
Well,
can everybody mute their line?
Hi. I can't see anybody.
I'm not sure that I can be heard.
We
can hear you. Whether I am being heard, I was asked to give a prayer and a few brief remarks. My name is Barry
Black,
and I am in the Washington, D.C. area. So
is that Eric Black?
Some way that I can know that I am communicating with anyone?
Yes, we can hear you.
And we can hear you.
Can't they see me?
Okay.
Hello. Can't see anybody.
Hello.
Can't see anybody.
You can't see anybody?
Hello.
Now we can see you.
I can see you.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
We can hear you. Well, it says that you can hear me, even though I can't see or hear anyone. So
we can hear you, Barry. Hey.
Hello.
A prayer.
Merv, what's up?
Happy birthday, Merv. And what an amazing milestone for intent. That we are promised by the sovereign God of the universe. I would like to offer this prayer in spite of the ringing in the background that hopefully will go away.
Somebody's calling.
Eternal God, live and move and exist. We thank you that you have provided with this milestone moment of being able to celebrate 70 years of life. We are grateful that
reception is very poor.
Your idea, and we continue to be blessed by his life and all of his tomorrows, We ask God that you would give Merv something to forgive each day, that he may grow in the grace of long suffering. Keep him kind and patient as he strives to imitate our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. May Merv seek your will for all of his goals and priorities. Lord, provide him with enough failure to keep his hands clenched tightly in yours. Give him also enough success to reassure him keep walking with you. We ask all of these blessings for Merv and for Paul. In the name of Jesus, the great lover of our souls. Amen.
Amen.
And amen.
I want to make just a few remarks. And Merv, I would challenge you to make the most of your days. I smiled. They talked about your long life. I am older than you. But we need to make the most of our days, and we find in the 90th Psalm, verse 12, these words, so teach us to number our days, not our weeks, not our months, not our years, but teach to number our days that we may have wisdom. Now this psalm is ascribed to Moses. Why should we make the most of our days?
Next left, and then
because life, even if you reach 70, life is brief. Shakespeare declared of life out brief candle. Life's a walking shadow. Poor player works and struts his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. So life is brief. We should make the most of our time because, or our days, because opportunities are also brief. In the play Julius Caesar, Shakespeare declares there is a tide in the affairs of people which, taken at the flood, leads on to fortune, omitted, and all the rest of life's voyage is bound by shallows and by middle. There are opportunities that you can miss. So if life is brief, opportunities are brief, how can we make the most of our days? And I just want to make three quick suggestions. First, use your time for eternal purposes. Mark 8:36 says, what does it profit a person to gain the whole world and lose his or her own soul? In the parable of the rich fool, our Lord in Luke 12 said of the man who had to build more barns because he had so much, he needed more storage room. Jesus said in Luke 12, 20, you fool, this night your soul will be required of you. Second, if you're going to make the most of your time, create a spiritual bucket list. Ask yourself the question, what do I hope to accomplish for the kingdom of God before I leave this world? And you can ask that question no matter what your age is. I keep in the back of my devotional Bible a to-do list for God, which basically has the things that I would like to accomplish before I transition from time into eternity. So, you use your time for eternal purposes. You make a bucket list of the things you want to accomplish for the kingdom of God before you die. And then the final step is you begin to take incremental or even baby steps in the direction of those goals on a daily basis. I think you'll be amazed at what you can accomplish for the kingdom of God if you continue to remember that eternity is more important than time. If you continue to remember that you need to strategize. Luke 14 says, who among you about to build a building does not first sit down and count the cost? So get a bucket list, make some plans, and then on a daily basis, take baby steps in the direction of those goals. Merv, happy birthday. What a great, great blessing to reach this milestone of 310. And may God continue to bless and keep both you and Paula, is my prayer. God bless you.
Okay. Thanks, Chaplain Black, first of all. We certainly appreciate his very touching words and the prayer that he offered to start today's program off. Now, the first thing I want to do here is I want to set the record straight. I've known Merv for a long time. I'm hoping that we can show you the invitation that was sent out. And I know most of you have seen it. The reason I know that is that many of you have, you've called me, you've been blowing up my cell phone, my email account. You've had the same question. And the question is particularly from people who have known Merv before he moved to Phoenix. Many of you are asking me the same question. For example, what's with this 310? I thought Merv was older than 70. Someone said to me, he's lying. I know he's older than 70. Some of you have always suspected that once Merv moved to Phoenix, he must have moved there under the witness protection program and given a new birth date. Because it surprises you that Merv now considers himself to be 310. I must confess to many of you that I'm just as surprised to hear that Merv is passing himself off in Phoenix, Arizona as being only 70 years of age. Ladies and gentlemen, they've planned tonight's program without my input. There are people that would have you believe that really Merv is only 70 years of age. I take no credit for organizing or arranging the program, for getting the speakers or the performers. But I do know this, the program will be excellent. The program as planned will give you a sense of what who Merv really is. You will hear from some of his closest friends. You will learn about Merv's time in the Caribbean, in Toronto, in the United States. Hopefully you will learn things about Merv that you never knew. Merv is a fascinating person. He is interesting, kind, insightful, talented, compassionate, and loving. I'm sorry, that's a statement that Paula gave me to read. She wrote it down. So I will take all of that back. Merv is the person that all of you know, the different facets of his personality. We will also share with you today artists who have special talents that will add an artistic flavor to tonight's program. Finally, there'll be a section where several of Merv's friends will be able to provide their personal insights about the Merv that they have come to know. The scheduled program will be informative, enlightening, and entertaining. But ladies and gentlemen, I have struggled mightily with today's program once I became aware of it. Some of you may know that I'm a lawyer by training. Lawyers have a reputation for telling the truth. So for me, the challenge was and still is, should I sit by and allow the program organizers to continue to perpetuate what I know and what many of you have suspected based on the tone and the substance of your questions to me? You've suspected that the program would have you believe that Merv is 70, and you believe that's a lie or a fraud. Ultimately, ladies and gentlemen, I've concluded that my own reputation must be upheld. And so in an effort to salvage my reputation, I'm constrained to tell you the truth. So out of my sense of duty, my goal today, in addition to the scheduled program, is to set the record straight. Over the course of tonight's program, I plan to make arguments to you and submit documents to you to dispel the myth that Merv is only 70 years old. He's older than Barry. I know it. All I ask you to do is to keep an open mind. Be willing to follow the arguments and to look at the documents that I am going to present to you. I think you'll be convinced that Merv is older than 70 before tonight's program is over. So with all due respect to Paula, his beautiful and lovely wife, and her team of graphic designers and communication gurus, purveyors of lies and fraud, I have taken the liberty of redesigning the invitation to reflect, in the words of Senator Mitt Romney, the truth. We need the truth, the unadulterated truth. Whether it hurts or not, we still need the truth. Merv is not 70, he's older than 70. So the first thing I've decided to do is to prepare a new invitation that is based on the truth. The next slide, I think, will more accurately reflect the invitation that should have been sent to you. It more accurately reflects the truth. Merv has been around for longer than 70 years. So I'm going to ask now that you observe the invitation that I have prepared. Right. Okay, there you are. This invitation says Merv's birthday celebration, most recent 70. Ladies and gentlemen, I submit to you that Merv is older than 70. We're actually celebrating the most recent 70. Now, with all the preliminaries out of the way, I'm going to remind you that you need to bear in mind that we need to follow the truth. Remain open-minded as we proceed with today's presentation. Now, in the first segment of our presentation today, there'll be presenters from Merv's close and inner circle. Two of his close friends are gonna present. His sister is gonna present. Royce and James is gonna present. We're gonna have a poem and a song. And then Wintley Phipps, one of Merv's oldest and closest friends, will be a presenter. Actually, let's scratch that. Let's just call Wintley one of his dearest friends. He may take issue with the fact that I've mentioned that he is one of Merv's oldest friends. So with that in mind, the program will proceed as scheduled. Please bear in mind that we are asking you to keep your mics on mute. You will now hear about Merv over the last 70 years from Veronica Dalrymple, Royce and James, another song, and then his children, a poem, and then Dr. Wintley Phipps.
Good night. I am Veronica, the youngest of moving siblings, which comprise of 7 children, 5 boys and 2 girls. Moving George is the 5th child and 4th male. You may be wondering, what can she say about her older brother if she's the youngest of them all? Well, I would have you know that I was reliably informed. The one thing that struck me while I was doing my research was that everyone mentioned that moving was always a good organizer. Even if it was a game of marbles, he had to let everyone know that there were rules to be followed. Never mind the participants of the game pitched marbles every day and so were well aware of those rules. Moving did not allow any cheating. I'm sure many of you would have admired Moving's dapper look, the pride in his clean and neat appearance. That started way back. He took pride in his appearance, and there was never a crease in his clothes, as he would spend long periods ironing to make sure they were smooth. I understand he took that even to the football or soccer field. Although he loved football, he did not particularly like playing when it rained. I'm sure you can guess why. Another of my brothers informed that he dreaded mud on his clothes. Pity this, rain falling. Everyone is focused on getting that ball into the goalpost. But Mervin, while he's watching the ball, is concerned about mud getting on his clothes. Mervin displayed the trait of leadership at an early age at school and always involved himself in some aspect of leadership. He was a class prefect or leader. He was involved in the soccer team. He was involved in the track and field team. He even started a football club in the community, and members of that club went on to play weekly competitions within the football league. Coming from a home which was the hub of the community and where many of the youths gathered to hang out and play, it was easy for Mervin to recognize, connect, and influence many to get into productive activities. There were many from that group who went on to become athletes in the country, top athletes if I may say so. Mervin's philosophy where games was concerned was if one is prepared and you played well, winning will be the outcome. And so he emphasized not thinking of winning, but preparing yourself, and winning will be the outcome. And so it was preparation meeting opportunity. He was of the belief that it was all in the mind. He felt playing soccer was more of a mental game than a physical one. Mervin always had the gift of speech, but oddly enough, he was never part of a debate club. And I'm sure some of you would agree with me that he would have done pretty well there. He was frequently reprimanded in school for not doing his homework. However, he always managed to finish in the top 3 in the class. Our father used to say to him, "There is no consolation for finishing 3rd. When he finished 2nd, our father would ask, "Why did you allow that boy to beat you?" And when he finished 1st, and he felt really good about himself, you guessed it, our father would say to him, "There is no reward, because that is what was expected of you." And so the bar was set pretty high. Few of you can imagine Mervin being a farmer. Yes, he was a farmer at one time. You see, my dad had goats, and every one of the boys had to take their turn. None escaped. The cleaning of the pens the feeding and milking of those goats. At home, Irving was always there. He was always the one to manage the things around the house. My older brothers were working and they contributed funds towards the upkeep of the home. And so his contribution was to ensure that the groceries and the cooking and the shopping and other domestic chores were taken care of, especially when our mother traveled overseas and was engaged in her work as a missionary and later as a pastor. The family thought that Mervyn would benefit from living in another country and decided, along with our uncle, Rudolph James, who lived in Canada at the time, that he should migrate to Canada. And so, Mervyn migrated to Canada and became Merv. The Merv that you see today and have known throughout the years did not emerge to be the great person that he is by chance. His father, Ebenezer, and mother, Iris, had both left a great legacy of innovation, leadership, empathy towards others, and genuine love for everyone, regardless of their station in life. Their combined life of service to others was an example to moving. Our father as a leader in the trade union, and our mother as a founder of mission schools, churches, and other notable community involvement. Mervyn lived these principles and engaged in the core values. Mervyn, on behalf of us siblings, nieces, nephews, and in-laws, we wish you a very happy birthday. May God continue to bless you and keep you, and may his face shine upon you. Remember, age is just a number.
Hello, everyone. I'm so happy that we're able to gather here together in celebration of Uncle Merv's birthday, even if it is virtual. My name is Rebecca Bond, and Uncle Merv and Auntie Paula took me in under their wing almost 20 years ago. It was during a difficult season for me, and when I say difficult, I mean I was hungry and they fed me, type of difficult. I truly believe that it was my mother's answer to prayer, and I think my mom's prayer went a little something like, "Lord, please help this child." It's not possible to say Merv and not Paula, or Paula and not Merv. They are each other's better half. So even though it's Merv's birthday, I felt it fitting to sing a song with a message from each of them to each other, because you are one another's best part. I love you both to the moon and back, and I don't know where I would be if you hadn't been there for me. Love you guys.
Part is the sunrise and the those brown eyes, yes. You're the one that I desire. When we wake up and we're in love, yes, it makes me feel so nice. You're my water when I'm stuck in the desert. You're my darling, all I take with my head hurts. You're the sunshine of my life. If you love me, won't you say something? If you love me, won't you? If you love me, won't you say something? If you love me, won't you? Love me, won't you? If you love me, won't you say something? If you love me, won't you? If you love me, won't you say something? If you love me, won't you?
Mervyn Williams arrived in Toronto, Canada in 1968, just in time to see Tommy Smith and John Carlos give the Black Power salute at the 1968 Olympics in Mexico City. The following summer, man landed on the moon for the first time, and I arrived that very night in the Great White North. Ever since, it's been my pleasure to watch the movements of the man we celebrate and roast tonight. Now, many of you watching tonight know a lot more about Mervyn than I do. That's why I tapped several of you to share some of your stories, at least the ones that are suitable for a mixed audience. Stories about the Toronto years of one Mervyn Williams. Now, the event organizers asked me to be the Toronto mouthpiece because I'm used to taking notes and then telling the people stories. Therefore, whatever you hear tonight, don't shoot the messenger. I'm just repeating what I heard. So first, the headlines. Mervyn in the cradle of Black Adventism in Canada. Mervyn the traffic ticket scammer. Mervyn the manager. Merv, I don't punch the clock, Williams. Merv the dream builder. Mervyn's legacy remains strong. Now the story. Now apparently flabbergasted at this gangly kid growing too fast and too sure of himself in Trinidad and Tobago, Mervyn's dad sent him to Canada, where Mervyn landed at Kingsway College outside Toronto. Now that's where his uncle, Pastor Rudolph James, recommended he attended school. Pastor James at the time was the pastor of the Toronto West SDA Church. He was the first Black Adventist pastor in Canada, pastoring the first Black Adventist congregation, a congregation that would become the cradle of Black Adventism in Canada. Now on weekends, Mervyn would travel to Toronto to be with his aunt, Ivory Saunders. She, Ivory Saunders, is still alive today at 90 years old. And she was one of the original 8 members who started the Toronto West SDA Church. So Mervyn being steeped in history, that's how he got started. The first Black pastor was clearing a path for him, and the mother of the mother church was taking care of him as a surrogate parent. Now, if this sounds like the boy should have been a saint, well, think again. The Saunders' son, Brian, and Brian's cousin, Earl Smith, they tell a different story, and they should know. Now, on Saturday night, their instruction from Mama Saunders was for them to go out together and return together. Well, they left together, all right. And the plan was always to return home together, even if it meant waiting outside the house until all three arrived. But Mervyn soon figured out it was better to return to the house on time, even if he was alone, than to break curfew, waiting for his partners in crime. "Man, I thought you guys were inside," Mervyn protested when Brian and Earl railed him for getting them in trouble. Now, often the boys drove the same vehicle. The driving naturally resulted in parking tickets. So Mervyn came up with a plan to help the boys pay for the traffic fines. "But why don't we pay into a traffic ticket fund? We'll pool our resources. That way we will always be able to pay our fines," Merv suggested. Now the boys agreed, seemed like a good idea, only to find out that Mervyn had already incurred multiple parking tickets and was now able to pay off his fines using their contributions. Mervyn was always ahead of his peers, planning and scheming beyond their imaginations, not just for his own benefit. Now, consider his early years at Kingsway College. On campus, there was this guy named Wintley, as in Phipps. He and Merv and a few black girls were the distinct minority on campus. I mean, we are in the great white north. But Mervyn saw an opportunity. Now, at the time, Earl and myself, you know, we were teenagers at Harvey Church. And then we had a church banquet. And the headline performers were from Kingsway College. Get this. Presenting Wintley Phipps and the Brown Sugars. Their quote unquote manager was Mervyn. Now, a few years later, now at Harvey Church, Mervyn saw four guys practicing as a quartet. Their names? Naturally, the Harveylights. Now, Mervyn started hanging around them. And, "Do you sing?" one of them asked him, but trying not to be too boastful about his singing prowess, Mervyn said, I manage." Now, the quartet totally misunderstood what Mervyn meant. As he left, Vernon Langdon told the quartet, "This is our answer to prayers. God has sent us a manager." So Merv managed the group for more than 25 years, booking them all over Canada and the United States, and produced two albums. Now, everyone knows that Mervyn Williams has presence. As Harold Junior Guerra puts it, he makes an indelible impression on you. I mean, he's not easily forgotten. Confident, well-groomed, immaculately dressed, shoes always well-polished. I mean, back in the day, the afro was Roberta Flack round, with not a strand out of place. And those three-piece suits? Huh. But the big question everyone wanted to know was, does he work? I mean, what does he do for a living? He never seems to be in one place for long. As Carl Hutchison puts it, certainly never in the realm of 9 to 5. No, Carl should know. Because when Phyllis asked him to check if there were any job prospects at Carl's company, Carl did a pre-interview with Mervyn. This is Carl speaking. "By the time I was done, Merv had convinced me that he could manage the whole company, not just be a leasing representative. So Merv went into the interview, wowed the interview panel, and was soon among the most productive leasing agents at Wang. Then Carl got a call from Merv's manager. "What happened to your guy? I mean, he just left. He just up and quit." "What? I mean, why did you leave, Merv?" "Well, Merv had bigger dreams than the company. It was too small a place for him. Besides, he wanted to be out and about meeting people in the community, so he left the secure job to become managing editor at the Black community newspaper." Yes, Merv was content not just with selling newspapers. But soon, he brought this beautiful young woman into the publisher's office. She needed sponsorship to enter the Miss Ontario Beauty Contest. and Merv felt Contrast could sponsor her as a goodwill gesture. Well, the young thing won the beauty contest. And there was Merv on stage with the publisher flanking Miss Ontario. See, if you had a dream and you traded with Merv, and he just be prepared to have him take the dream and blow it up into a life pursuit. He would come up with all kinds of ways to help you achieve your dream, and yes, push it way beyond your horizons. Believed him because in his own pursuits, he always seemed to come up wrong. Now, Merv took up promoting company, if you remember that, promoting concerts in Toronto, in addition to managing the likes of the Silhouettes and Melissa Prescott. He promoted concerts like the Heritage Singers, Wintley Phipps, the Winans, and others. And when he booked Tremaine Hawkins and she canceled at the last minute, Merv didn't sweat. He contacted his buddy Wintley, and the stand-in were this fresh new brother-sister tandem. And BB and CC Winans just tore up the place. So for many of us, you know, we've had so many great experiences with Merv, and we met him and exchanged so many good memories on the playing field. Now, you know, bowling, I mean, that's not, I don't consider that a sport, but for, and I know Merv and all his friends are going to be hitting me for this, but Merv started a bowling league that continues to this day, involving just about everyone at Apple Creek, starting with the likes of Vernon Langdon and the Trowers and the Lopez's. And then next thing you know, their kids were playing, and now their kids' kids are playing. Track and field, back in the 70s, I mean, Merv and I used to boast about which church had the fastest runners, Harvey or Apple Creek. So guess what? We started a track and field meet at Brockton Stadium. Well, the meet continues to this day as a huge annual event. Football, no, not soccer, the American version. Football, that was a sport new to us Caribbean folks. But not, well, Merv picked up the sport at Kingsway, and he was playing for a team that played in the Canadian Championships. So Merv went to Seneca College to rent their field for a game. No, this is typical Merv. He went in to rent the field for one game. He left, not just with the permit for that game, but the Seneca manager hired Merv to run an entire football league out of Seneca College. Now, Merv then contacted me to enter a church team. That church team, called the Toronto Saints, still exists, and hundreds of players have been able to play football without joining other teams that tempted them to play on the Sabbath. Last sport, soccer. Now, Merv considers himself a soccer player. But what position do you think Merv plays? Nowhere near in the thick of things. He plays way out on the wing where he can make a few blazing runs a game, grab everyone's attention, but not break a sweat. Has anyone ever seen Merv Williams break a sweat? No, sir. But we know he's always working for us, building our legacy and preparing a foundation that is sure to last as long as we're in God's earth. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in just saying thank you to Merv Williams, the great, unforgettable, amazing, resourceful, visionary, one-of-a-kind Mervin Williams. At age 70, he is like he appeared at age 20, without spot or ring. Good night.
Merv, I remember the first Sabbath that I saw you and your beautiful wife, Paula, when I moved here back in 2010. I had no family. I came to the church very new, and you all welcomed me and my daughter as well. And you've been an inspiration ever since.
And we noticed that you all were faithful in your service and in everything that you do. Everything was excellent. It was like, it was perfect. And it was such an inspiration that today I've chosen to sing for you, "He's Been Faithful," in honor of your faithful service to Camelback and to others. Both of you are a demonstration of how when a couple works together to serve God in excellence, all things come together and they come together well. When I grow up, I want to be just like you both. Happy birthday, Merv, and may God bless you richly. And may He continue to bless you richly with long life and with prosperity. Happy birthday.
In my moments of fear, through every pain, every tear, there's a God who's been faithful to me. When my strength was all gone, when my heart had no song, still in love, He's been faithful to me. Every word that He's promised is true. What I thought was impossible, I've seen my God do. He's been faithful.
Faithful to me.
Sin, good evening. Good evening. Thank you so much for taking your time for this shoot. It's a special day. Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you. Yeah, that's good.
All right, I think we got it.
Wonderful, thank you. Good evening, everyone. My name is Bill Danforth from Tempe, Arizona, and I'm pleased to be here tonight to celebrate Merv's, you know, Sam, there's a little problem we have here. This isn't gonna work. First and foremost, this mask isn't right. I mean, there's a time to wear a mask, and then there's a time not to wear a mask, and this is not it. So I'm going to just take this off, if you don't mind, and actually, I'm gonna get comfortable. I wanna take this tie off as well, if you don't mind. Yes. Lady Di, if I could get your help. Yeah, thank you, there's that. And I wanna get this jacket off too, if you don't mind. Okay. There we go. There we go. Thank you. Perfect. There, let me undo this. Phew. Yeah, that's a lot better. That's a lot better. So, Sam, whenever you're ready, why don't we roll it? Good evening. My name is Bill Danforth, and I'm excited to send Mr. Merv Williams birthday greetings from Tempe, Arizona. What an honor it is to be invited to this very special celebration and have this opportunity to say a few words about Merv and share just a little bit of his life's history and the journey here in Arizona. Although I'm honored to be here, I must say I'm a little intimidated. Having the opportunity to personally attend Paula Williams' Gailey 60th birthday celebration in December of 2018, attended by so many of the who's who. Now fast forward to 2021 and Merv's 70th birthday celebration, and it's a COVID Zoom extravaganza with 300 of Merv's closest friends. 300 people? How will that work? Do we maybe go to a drive-in theater to get a screen large enough to see everyone? Bottom line, the level of intimidation is not only how many people are here, but who they are. Such a remarkable list of people we have presenting at this gala event. It's just a little intimidating, to say the least, after looking at some of their resumes. It really kind of reminds me of my favorite Johnny Carson episode. It was March 6, 1969. Johnny was in top form with Ed McMahon and Doc Severinsen. At the top of the show, Johnny let everybody know that George Gobel was a key guest for the evening. Well, the next thing you know, Bob Hope walks out and takes over the show. He was a huge hit with his classic dry wit and humor and stand-up comedy. Next came out Dean Martin. He strolls out and proceeds to get the audience roaring in their seats. What a 1-2 punch. Finally, with no introduction, sad sack George Gobel appears on the stage. Dean asks, "Who is this?" Bob says, "I think it's George Gobel." Bob and Dean move over to make room for poor George. George sits down and he looks directly into the camera and says, "Do you ever feel like the world's a tuxedo and you're a pair of brown shoes?" Well, that's kind of how I feel tonight. Anyway, here we go. My key objective today is to explore Merv's life journey here in Arizona. Initially, I thought this would be a simple assignment. However, after taking some time to look into Merv's Arizona life and personally talking with many, many other people, it became apparent this would not be an easy slam dunk. So many people and so many comments. How does one summarize Merv's life? Oh, by the way, did Merv mention to me that he was the least productive of all of his siblings? The challenges Merv faces are not really entirely his own fault, as we are all products of our environment. I cannot begin to tell you the number of people who consistently shared similar stories about Merv and how he's touched their lives. And by the way, their names will be withheld to protect the innocent. Merv was born and raised for the first 18 years of his life, enjoying the rhythmic sounds of the Caribbean island of Trinidad. Picture this: light ocean breezes, relaxing days under slowly moving waving palm trees, umbrellas in every colorful drink. Next, for the next 20 years, while living in Toronto, Canada, we just kind of mix in a little world-class and European French-Canadian culture. Now picture this: we now have a man who is laid back, cool and relaxed, cultured and refined to the nth degree, now coming to Arizona, the land of cactus, cowboys, and horses. Mr. Sophisticated and Relaxed meets the Wild West. What brought Mr. Williams to Arizona, you ask? Well, it was the spring of 1986, my error, in Toronto that led Merv to Arizona. He said the reason was due to illness. I asked Merv, what were you sick with? Merv's response, he was simply sick of the cold and the snow. Merv had never even heard of Phoenix, Arizona. All he was doing is he was simply looking for warm weather, reasonable cost of living, and no major weather issues. Oh, and by the way, prior to venturing out to the Grand Canyon State, Merv had met a beautiful and very young, and I mean very young, nursing student in Toronto by the name of Paula Bridge. And as they say, the rest is history. They were married in Toronto on August 9th, 1989, and soon they began their maiden voyage to Arizona. And actually, so we all know, the reason I'm bringing Paula up right now and into this equation is that I met her first before I met Merv at all. But that's a completely different story for a completely different time. When asked, what are your key thoughts of Merv Williams? The responses I received were refined, regal, eloquent in speech, a cool operator like Katie Winters, or cool, calm, and collected, or like Mr. Teflon, where nothing sticks, debonair, sophisticated, quite the fashion statement. At home, actually, we simply refer to Merv as Mr. Peacock. He's always looking so GQ, strutting around. We question if he wears tuxedo pajamas to bed. Merv is also the master of one-liners, one quick joke after another. Perhaps he missed his calling as a stand-up comic. However, understanding Merv's punchline is a totally different thing, so I simply chalk it up to his Caribbean and Canadian influences. Unfortunately, other comments were a little less flattering for Mr. Williams, such as, boy, Merv can sure talk. It's my understanding that while in a meeting, he's oftentimes limited to only one question due to time constraints, or when receiving a personal call. Due to the length of the call, you may need to notify Merv and tell him that your cell battery is on fumes. Or perhaps maybe you're driving and Merv calls you. 20-minute drive or an hour drive makes no difference. The conversation needs to end since you've reached your destination. Merv is always willing to help out at all kinds of social gatherings. His heart's in the right place. However, here is where the phrase, Merv, just serve the drinks, comes from. This is code talk. Code talk to say, Merv, please stay out of the way and we'll get everything handled. But his intentions are always good. Another question that came up a lot was, what does Merv do for work? It's been one of the top questions and brings to mind the TV shows Father Knows Best, starring Robert Young as a dad Jim Anderson, or Leave It to Beaver, where Hugh Beaumont is playing Ward Cleaver. You never knew what these guys did for work either. Well, anyway, this kind of puts a bow and sums up the light roast for the man of the evening. So on to a different note. I'd like to share what Merv has meant to those who I've talked to. The comments were, Merv gives selfishly of himself to help others grow and succeed. He gives of his time. He gives with his knowledge. He gives with his continual encouragement. He always gives with mentorship by helping others attain their full potential. Give so others can be proud of their accomplishments. Merv is simply a positive influence on the lives of others. He plants the seeds so others can grow. When asking Merv core questions about his life in Arizona, and if he could do things all over again, what would he do? Well, the word that comes to mind for me is humble, is one of the key words. His focus is on comforting and guiding others. He wants to be a person that others can trust. The legacy that his parents instilled in him to put service first, to put others first, to be generous, to be unselfish, and to share with others. Merv was taught to be independent, which he in turn has instilled in his children, Quentin and Lexi. Merv does not rely on external things to bring him joy, happiness, and fulfillment. He gives freely and he gives often, whether to our church family as an elder, head deacon, board member, heading up our concert series, teaching Sabbath school class, or working with the Arizona Pacific Union Conference. Merv gives 100% of himself, always. I know that he cherishes his mission trip experiences in Rwanda, Africa, as well as Ecuador, South America. Merv's personal interest in being an advocate for prostate cancer patients and a prostate cancer awareness has been invaluable for so many men. Lastly, I would be remiss not to note his wonderful support and assistance with Jessica and Sam of Jesus Music Ministry, helping them share their talent and God's love for us through music. In closing, I would just simply like to share with you what Merv Williams has meant to me personally. As a new Christian in 2008, and my life had not always been Christ-centered, Merv then, and even more today, is a wonderful influence showing me how a Christian man lives his life. Life with his family, life with his church, and life with those outside of his church family. And most important, he's sharing personally with me his close walk with our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Merv, what a positive influence you have been in my life. Words alone cannot express my thanks to you. Happy 70th birthday, my friend. Happy 70th birthday. Sam, I think that's a wrap. I think we can take it. And hopefully it came out fine. And bottom line, the good news is I don't have to put on my tie. I don't have to put on my jacket, but I am going to put my mask on. This has been a crazy year in 2020, and these masks are important for us and for others. And I wish more of us wore these masks during 2020, and we may not be where we are today, right now with this COVID. Hopefully 2021 will be a better year for all of us. So again, Sam, thank you for taking it. And that's a wrap.
Now, Stefan and I would just like to wish you a very happy birthday on your 70th. We're sorry that we cannot be there with you to celebrate this momentous time of year, but due to COVID, we're in the Great White North. So happy birthday from my family and from Stefan's family.
Happy birthday, Dad.
Hi, Grandpa. Happy birthday. On behalf of all the grandkids, we want to say happy birthday to you. Wish you all the best, good life, good health, and we love you.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday. Peace. Peace.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Papa.
Happy birthday to you.
Yay!
My first impression of Merv, I am pretty sure, was that this man always has such perfect posture. Of course, I also said, as some still often say, that guy looks a lot like Sidney Poitier. As we got acquainted, I came to realize Merv is always ready to offer his advice. He has no lack of opinions, and that just makes sense. Merv is a man with many years of experience. In the time that I have known him, which isn't all that long, he has been a jack of all trades. Now tell me, am I wrong? Merv's list of jobs and earning schemes speaks to his confidence. He jumps right in and gives his all in every circumstance. He's always up to the challenge because God has given Merv a character that seems to thrive on different ways to serve. He's full of positivity and quite the visionary in his church roles and even as a short-term missionary. I interrupt this poem for a message I must state. On behalf of Merv, to all you men, go check on your prostate. He is a true survivor, and how very proud I am that he bravely let a doctor give him that exam. Merv and I don't always see eye to eye on everything. We disagree on politics and the way I ought to sing. We have misunderstandings. At times, he drives me mad. But in the end, he's still my friend and really not that bad. Merv once made me a promise, one that he's been true to keep. He said he'd always be my friend. His loyalty runs deep. He has encouraged me to do more than I thought I could. His support remains an influence in my life for good. So here's to our friend Merv, the man behind the polished style, the guy who's quick to laugh and always greet you with a smile. May your joyful days be many and your trying days be seldom. I know these words have touched your heart, so I'll bow and say you're welcome.
Hello, Merv. Happy birthday, my brother. It has been a blessing and honor to have known you now for 60 years, give or take a few. And today I count it a privilege, Merv, to be able to send my congratulations to you on the occasion of your 70th birthday. What can I say about Merv? Well, if I could pick out a few words from the English Language Dictionary to describe Merv, the first word would be for me, friend. Friend. Mervin, you have always been to me a good friend. A friend who has been blessed with great intelligence and integrity. And I've always known you, Merv, to be a consummate professional and magnificently knowledgeable. You pick a topic and Merv can share with you thoughts and perspectives that are insightful and refreshing. Merv, you've always had an uncanny ability to break down difficult topics and themes so others could see another way of looking at the world. And if you left the dictionary and opened a thesaurus, and you looked in the thesaurus for a synonym for the word cool, don't be surprised if one of the synonyms was Mervin Cool Williams. You see, I have seen up close and personal Mervin under pressure. I've seen Merv draw strength from crises, and then I've seen him move with wisdom in the most stressful and complicated of situations. Frankly, I don't know how he does it. No matter the challenge, the difficulty, the trial, Mervin never seems to get flustered or ruffled in his temperament, attitude, tenor, or tone. Mervin, I've always looked up to you, my brother. You are the epitome of cool. Hey, have you noticed when Mervin steps out on a stage, he always looks like he owns a haberdashery? Mervin, you've always dressed like one cool brother. And now on a personal note, I must say whenever I have needed help, whenever I've needed encouragement, Mervin, you've always been there for me. I've always known you to be a spiritual man, a God-fearing man, a family man, a man who loves his God and loves his church. And to me, Mervyn, you've always been a dedicated, compassionate, and a generous man, a kind father, a caring husband, and yes, now a doting grandfather. Mervyn, you are now officially 10 years away from 80. And with Paula by your side and your family in your corner, your years ahead are going to be filled with joy, laughter, and beauty. Mervyn, if there is one lesson I gathered from you early in my ministry, it was this lesson. You may dream alone, but you never achieve alone. I thank you, my elder brother, for all those marvelous principles you imparted to me when I was a much younger man myself. And so now as I leave you, Mer, I don't want to presume to give you, my elder brother, any counsel. And if I had to do so, it would be simply this. Merv, live your years ahead to their fullest. Merv, live your years ahead to their fullest. And remember, God has a special crown for you, my brother. And when Jesus puts it on your head, we all plan to be there to say, that's our Merv. That's our friend Mervyn. And so happy birthday, my friend. May the years ahead treat you kindly. And may God shower you, shower your days with his grace and favor. Your friend and younger brother, Wintley.
When you walk through a storm, hold your head up high and don't be afraid of the dark. At the end of a storm is a golden sky and the sweet silver song of a lark. Walk on through the wind, walk on through the rain, though your dreams be tossed and glow. Oh. tossed and blown. Walk on, walk on with hope in your heart, and you'll
Toronto Merv. But ladies and
gentlemen, let's return to my comment.
My stated objective.
We need to speak the truth.
Consider what Royce and James said.
Merv looks like he never sweats.
What human being does that? Royston also said that Merv looks as fresh now as he did when he was 20. Who does that? Again, ladies and gentlemen, I submit to you that Merv is just 70 years of age. Now, some of you may be skeptical of what I'm saying to you. You would still rather have the myth. You'd rather believe the myth. You can't believe that such an upstanding citizen like Merv Williams will mislead you. Well, you're not alone. The truth is that the forces of deception are strong. Merv has engaged in deception for a long time, and frankly, none of us are any match for Merv. Again, I ask you, please keep an open mind. Not fooled by the notion that Merv is only 70. I plan to try to convince you otherwise. Remember what Bill Danforth said. It was not a slip of tongue. 1886. Keep an open mind, ladies and gentlemen, as we move to the next segment. In this segment, we're going to have several toasts. Ed Keyes is going to present, and then Richard Ricardo Graham is also going to present. They're persons at the Adventist Union and the Congress. We'll then hear a presentation that's pre-recorded from James and Paula Wilson. They've known Merv since his college, Charles and Diane White. And finally, we'll be blessed with a violin performance by Allison. So sit back and enjoy the second segment of our program.
To my dear friend, Merv Williams, we understand this is a special birthday for you. Someone told me it was your 17th birthday. Well, maybe I'm off a few years, but I was so glad to wish you a happy birthday. And we feel honored, privileged, both myself and my wife, to be asked by your dear spouse to say something on your birthday. It has been a privilege to work with you over the years on all of our committees, our executive committee, our board of ed, and personnel and so forth, and even with the union, being able to go there from time to time and just enjoy your friendship and the fellowship we have together. I always appreciate what you do for us in Arizona, but for me personally, I'm standing in my house that you found for me 17 years ago, almost 18 now. And thank you again. My wife has something to say as well.
Hi, Merv. Happy birthday. We are so excited. It is an honor to be able to wish you a happy birthday. And we just pray that God will bless you and bless you and bless you some more. You have been a friend to us since we first came to Arizona. And I love the house you helped Ed find for us, because we bought it sight unseen. I didn't see it until I got here, and it was already bought. But we just thank you for your dedication, your passion for God, for your beautiful wife and family, for your church family, and how you're willing to do whatever it takes to make God's work go forward. God bless you, Merv. Happy birthday. May God bless you with lots of health, lots of love, lots of joy and peace, and a closer work with God. Walk with God. God bless you. Bye.
Happy birthday, my friend.
Hello. It's my pleasure to bring birthday wishes to Merv Williams. Merv, you have attained the age of 70. Wow. Welcome to the age of wisdom and experience. You have not only survived, but you have thrived. And as a member of the Pacific Union Conference Executive Committee, you bring your well-seasoned information and explorative questioning mind to our processes. We are a better committee because you, Merv, have shared your influence and your point of view as we try to support all of the 7 conferences within the Pacific Union. Thank you for your work, and may God make this one of your happiest birthdays ever. Thank you, my friend. God bless.
Keep moving. You know, a wise man once said, forget your past, you can't change it. But I'd like to add, forget about your present. I guess I didn't get you one, so that would fit. But you know, but then again, what do you get a guy who has everything? I mean, you got a beautiful wife and children who love you, grandkids who adore you, and friends who admire you. You know, these are the most important things to a guy who at 70 years has accomplished so much and can look back on a life well-lived and look forward to great things to come. A guy with a lot of class, a guy who's a great friend, and a guy who's one in a million. Yes, your best years are ahead, and looking back, I'm so glad that we stayed in touch, and I'm honored to be your friend. By the way, now that you've joined the Distinguished Club of Septuagenarians, I feel it my duty to give you at least one piece of advice, and I'm speaking from experience. If you ever feel a big sneeze coming on, okay, don't forget to cross your legs real tight and hope for the best. Just saying. Happy birthday, Merv.
Hi, Mervin. We really wish that we could have been there to celebrate with you on your 70th birthday. Happy birthday. I don't know why Jimmy didn't include me at the beginning of his video, but at any rate, I'm here now, and I want to wish you again a very, very happy 70th birthday. Congrats. God bless.
A 70th birthday tribute to our dear Merv.
as inspired by Dr. Seuss.
This is a humble tribute to our highly esteemed, greatly admired,
talented, genuine, remarkable, capable, affable, erudite, loquacious, articulate,
wise, philosophical, supportive, affirming, accepting and open, courteous and cheerful,
stately and proper, easygoing and calm, composed and thoughtful, fun and funny, adorable friend,
who has the bearing of a prince
and the heart of a servant. Let the tribute begin.
Let the bells ring, let the horns blow.
Sir Merv is turning the big 7-0.
This isn't gossip, it's honestly true.
Who'd ever have thought it? Whoever knew?
He's eternally youthful in looks, we all know.
But the calendar is saying it's the big 7-0.
Now the 7 is a gambler's friend.
But yikes, it gets scary with an O at the end.
With Merv, we've had many years full of great friendship.
He's a very rare guy who has always been real hip.
He has had years full of service and giving to others.
Merv really does love folks as sisters and brothers. His heart is as big as those mansions he sells. His kindness runs as deep as both of our wells.
We can tell you that story some other year. We've had over 1,200 feet worth of well drilled out here.
Charlie has sweet memories of Merv as head deacon. He was always so giving. He shined like a beacon, an elder who always had lots of really good advice. And whether it was taken or not, Merv was always so nice.
Merv reminds Diane of a favorite actor, a suave, cool man with a voice full of laughter. Merv, we both are so thankful to call you our friend.
And to celebrate birthday number 7 with an O at the end.
And now, as for birthdays, we wish you many more.
This is sent with much love to our friend we adore. Happy birthday, Merv.
We love you. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Hi Merv, I'm really honored to participate on this birthday celebration. What a great idea. I'm really happy because I've met you, and I hope you have a great year ahead of you full of blessings. Happy birthday, and I hope you enjoy this next song. Thank you.
Yeah, that's okay.
God, it's an opportunity for me to give my tribute. I'm trying to unmute, but for some reason it's not unmuting. So I'm going to use this mic. I'm not sure why you're not getting picture. Can you go over to the Zoom? I'm on the Zoom. I think that's going to be better, but it's not even. Happy birthday, Merv. Can you hear me, buddy? I don't know if you can see me, but if you can't see me, that's okay. Just let you know we love you. And since you can't see me, I'm going to do something I know that you can hear. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Mervyn. Happy birthday to you. God bless you, my friend.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. I'm back. So I've told you before,
hey,
I want you to keep an open mind. I'm convinced that I can convince you that Merv is older than he wants you to believe. So before we move to the next segment, I want to make my first argument to you. It's based on information that I have received and that I think is really, really reliable. Now remember, I'm a lawyer, and we don't lie. So listen carefully to what I have to say about Merv. Ladies and gentlemen, my father was born in 1927. And before he passed, my father told me that his father, my grandfather, knew Merv. Now again, I'm a lawyer and I will not lie, but ladies and gentlemen, that is strong, powerful, and persuasive evidence that Merv is definitely older than 70. You can't really dispute it. He's older than 70. He knows it. He's lying, and Paula is trying to enable him. The second argument that I wish to make is based on information that Murph told me himself. He does not want to share this information with you. He provided it to me in strict confidence. Now, normally there's an attorney-client privilege, but of course there is an exception. The exception exists when there's clear, uncontroverted evidence of fraud. The truth is, ladies and gentlemen, the truth is, Merv has traced his lineage, their ancestry.com, to Africa. And he's learned that 10% of his ancestors are from Sierra Leone. But did you know, ladies and gentlemen, did you know that ancestry.com reveals that 90% of Merv's ancestors are from the countries of Turkey in an area once known as Mount Ararat? And another percentage of his ancestors are from Egypt in an area around Mount Sinai. Merv has a rich history, but it's an ancient history, ladies and gentlemen. He cannot be 70 as he claims. Ladies and gentlemen, Merv has friends from the Philippines. He has friends from Romania and Russia and Canada. He even had friends from Union Island. You combine all of that circumstantial evidence, he can't be 70. He is definitely older than that. How old? How much older? We'll find out. But let's take it one step at a time. He is definitely older than 70. Merv and Paul tried to convince you otherwise, but ladies and gentlemen, trust me on this. Trust me on this. I'm a lawyer and we don't lie. Merv and Paul are trying to deceive you. He's older than 70. We'll move to the third segment and I'll have some more information for you later. In this segment, we'll have some toasts from friends that know Merv very well. They're largely pre-recorded toasts. And there's also a trumpet solo or rendition that's gonna be pre-recorded. Please sit back and listen and enjoy, and I'll bring you some more evidence later. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. I'm so honored to say a few words on behalf of the birthday man, Mervy Williams. Happy birthday to you. I just wanted to share a few things about Merv that you may not have known, or some of you may have thought it, but just never had enough courage to ask. Well, I want to be able to share with you Merv in a way that some of you may not know. I noticed that the Master of Ceremonies had timelines as to Merv in Trinidad, Merv in Canada, Merv in the United States. And fortunately, I can speak as an expert because my dad pastored in Trinidad and I was introduced to Merv in the 50s. I was a baby And at the time I was introduced to Merv by my dad, he was my dad's elder in the church, and he was about 60 years old then. Yes, he was. Then he matriculated to Canada. And it just so happened that I went to high school in Canada, the same school that Merv was one of the trustees. He was on the board there. And while we were in Canada as a high school young person, Merv was actually 70 years old then at that time. He did really well. At least that's the time he tells us that he was 70. He may have been 170 at that time. And here's why. I'll tell you why. I want to just share with you an anatomological study that I did on Merv. And you need to know this. Methuselah lived to be 969 years old, the oldest man purportedly who ever lived. Well, I have some facts to present to you, and then you decide. I'm just here to present it and tell you my thoughts. If you noticed, Methuselah and Mervin both begin with the letters M-E. There's a reason for that. They both, their names end in Selah. Yeah, his name is not Mervin. His name is actually Mervi Selah. The first five letters, Methu, the first five letters of Merv is Mervi, M-E-R-V-Y. And the reason Selah is not as important in their names, it does bring significance, but it's not as important. Selah is in the Bible, if you read it when the Psalms are being read, you'll see a Selah at the end of some Psalms. That is a musical rest, or it's a time that you pause, a musical pause from the singing of the Psalms or from the reading of the Psalms. So we'll take Selah out of Methuselah's name, and we'll take Selah out of Mervi's name. He's actually Mervi Selah, and there's a reason for that, as I shared with you. Well, here we go. Methuselah, Methu. M adds in the Hebrew Greek language, M equals 500. E equals 400, so that's 900. T is 19. H is nothing, is zero. U is 50. If you add those numbers up, you'll get 969. Let's do the same thing with Mervi. M 500, E 400. R is 20. Y is no value. And if you add V and U, which is the U of Methuselah, both at 50, Merv is at 50, that will come up to 970. What I'm trying to say is Merv is on par to be the oldest man who ever lived. He's going to be 970 years old, the oldest man who would have ever lived. That's quite a feat. And I am just honored that Merv has been around this long and he has kept himself so well. Mervi Selah, Mervi Selah. Don't forget that. Think of the numbers. As a matter of fact, when in my anatomological study, I also found out that Merv is not 70. He's doing that for us to understand ages. Merv is actually 700 years old. Actually 700 years old today. Or we're celebrating it today. And so in my own antediluvian way, which only Merv could understand, I'm going to wish him a happy birthday in the antediluvian language. So he will really feel at home. Mervi. Translation, happy 700th birthday, Merv. God bless you. Appreciate you. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Jacqueline Sandy, and Merv Williams is a very, very dear friend. It's my honor to do this for you, Merv. Happy birthday. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Jacqueline Sandy, and I have known Merv since I was 8 years old. We met in Toronto, Canada, where he became my music manager. I sang in a trio called The Silhouettes for 13 years. Mervin was our music manager. He was extraordinary, focused. We had some incredible experiences together. And beyond that point, Mervin moved to the United States in the late 80s with his family. I moved to Atlanta, Georgia to work for the Canadian Consulate General. And so Merv and I stayed in touch, thank God, and he continued to provide advice. In fact, so much so that, quite frankly, if I faced any situation that was troubling or if I needed any advice, Merv would be the person that I would go to. So Merv has served many roles in my life. Let me take you to where I'm going with this. Merv has literally been my doctor, my lawyer, my plumber, my mechanic, my contractor, my insurance consultant, my mortgage consultant, my music consultant, because I sang with a group here in Atlanta for over 20 years. And so he has been a tremendous vessel of consistent encouragement when I needed it. He has been a comedian. He has been a life coach, a true brother, and most importantly, my friend. Merv, happy birthday to you. I pray that God continues to bless you and enrich your life with good health. I know you're surrounded by love, so you're good there, and I'm happy for you. May God bless you for every single time you picked up the phone to help me. Happy birthday, Merv. Love you, Jack.
Affectionately, we call him Merv. And we smile when we say Merv, because Merv is smiling back at us. And his smile is bigger than ours. Merv has a natural smile that lights up the room. I'm so thankful that I've had Merv as a friend. I returned from the United States after being away for 10 years. And I returned to assume the pastorate of the Agent Court Seventh-day Adventist Church, where Merv was a member, a prominent member. And we struck up a friendship. We connected right away. Merv is among the most supportive members that I've ever pastored in any church. I pastored four churches, and Merv stands out as perhaps the most supportive member, at least among the most. And so I love Merv. I felt his love and support, and so we connected. We really connected very nicely. See, pastors love members like Merv for at least two reasons. Number one, Merv manifests the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. He has all of those. Goodness, self-control. And he exerts this influence over the church because he affects so many people. His personality is such that, this positive, smiling, joyful, loving person. So he affects the church. So pastors love, and I really appreciated Merv for that, and also for his gifts. Now, those are the fruit of the Spirit that he manifested, but then he has gifts. The gift of organizing and administrating. He is good at also producing, that comes with that, producing and promoting. Now, people pay, churches pay money for those gifts. And Merv did it for us free of charge. Merv, you have arrived at the age of 70. I know David says that a man's lifespan is 70. But you know, David was living in an age where we didn't have the kind of medical care, and we didn't have the knowledge about health, this healthful living that we have now. And so I know you will live for a long time. In fact, I am hoping and wishing you a long life. You know, here at Loma Linda, we have people living to 100 and jogging on a regular basis. So I wish that you live to 100 and more in good health. In fact, better than that, I'm going to wish that you live forever. I trust that Jesus would return before you get to 100 and you will be translated. I hope to be translated with you so that we can continue our friendship in heaven and we can live through the ceaseless ages of eternity. And so I want to wish you a happy birthday, a happy 70th birthday, and may you have many, many more. And now I want to, on behalf of my wife, Barbara, who is around here somewhere in this house, I want to wish you a happy birthday, and I want to lift a toast to you for many, many more.
Mervin Williams, love you, man. Heard you had a birthday, or you're gonna have one, or maybe we're having one right now. But I wanna tell you a couple things. Number one, I love you and appreciate you. You've been there for me. Your family's been there for me. I'll never forget. I'll always be a better man because of knowing you. So I was privileged to be asked to play a song for you. You know, I like the trumpet. I know you've appreciated me and driven me to things I wouldn't have done without your influence and without your prompting. So the song tonight, or today, or whatever hour that is put on this time, may you know it's from my heart to yours. And I do love you for many reasons. One, I actually love your wife more than I love you, but we'll talk about that another time. But it's your day today, and I love both of you. You guys have made my life special, and so many other people's lives special too. And you got great kids. Anyway, here's the song, From My Heart to Yours. God bless you, brother. Happy birthday.
Bye.
Love you. Thanks. Happy birthday.
That was incredible. I've never met Bobby McGee before, but I think he and I have something in common. Probably he has something in common with a lot of us. He loves Merv's wife more than he loves Merv. Wow. And Dr. Clyde Kasimi, he wants Merv to live forever. That man must be a prophet. Merv lived forever. He's been around for a long time. And Jackie Sandy, it's good to see you. I've known Jackie for a number of years. There's a Garth Gabriel. I'm not sure who he is, but he's kind of funny. I like him. I will say this. He has made my point. He's a wise man, clearly. He's very knowledgeable. He's a scientist. Those words come from somebody who is well-versed, and I congratulate him because he makes the point that I'd like to make here today. Merv is more than 70 years of age. Listen, I'm gonna show you some documents at this point. The next document I'm gonna show you has some historical significance. I obtained this document here from the Library of Congress. As many of you know, Merv has been to Africa. He loves cruise vacations. But the next document has both history and provenance. This document is as close as you can get to a smoking gun to shed light on Merv's actual age. The document has two important things to show. First of all, it's going to show that Merv loves sailing. But the second thing the document is going to show, and perhaps the most important thing is going to show, is that it's credible and important, a clue that we're gonna have here today in building my argument to you, ladies and gentlemen, in building my argument to you that Merv is lying to you and Paula Williams is enabling her. Ladies and gentlemen, based on the next document, it's gonna be clear to you, Merv is not 70. He just isn't. Let's see the next photograph here. Ladies and gentlemen, that's Merv on a sailing ship. In 1492, Merv is not 70. He just isn't. Merv is close to 1,500 years old, at least. Do not listen to Merv and Paula. They're trying to mislead you. Merv is at least 1,500 years old, ladies and gentlemen. I'm a lawyer, and we don't lie. Trust me on this. Trust me. I have more evidence, though, and I'm going to ask you to bear with me. Look at the evidence. I've given you the arguments based on testimony. I've shown you now this historical documents, but I've got more. I am going to convince you, ladies and gentlemen. I will. I will convince you, if it's the last thing I do, that Merv G. Williams is not 70. Take the pastor's word for it. Take this historical document's word for it. Merv is at least 1,500 years of age. We'll now move to our next segment. In this segment, ladies and gentlemen, we'll be hearing from Suzanne Bouchard. We'll hear from LBJ and Billy, then from Dr. Kinsley Parma. And then we've got a comedian before we hear a steel pan rendition. So again, sit back, listen, enjoy, and I've got some more evidence for you. It's gonna be powerful. You're gonna believe. I know it, because Merv and Paula are lying. Let's get back to the show.
Hey Mervin, happy birthday, happy birthday. I would love to sing to you, but I'm so not a good singer. I can't carry a tune out the door. So here we are on Zoom. Hi, everybody. And I've got to read this. I'm sure all of you have to read this because here we are on Zoom. So Merv, I'm starting off with, I'm sure you know, you won't be, you'll say, oh yeah, that's Suzanne. The analysis of Mervyn. The users of this name are usually somber, high ability of persuasion, yes, hardworking, innovative, stubborn, but usually happy. Letters analysis, specific analysis for each letter. Okay, here we go for Mervyn. M, you're zealous. M. Oh, I'm not so used to doing this. E, logical. R, dreamer. V, colorful.
Okay.
I, zany. I don't know why. And N, helpful. Oh my God, that's a lot of work. Your numerology analysis, monsieur. Loyal, curious, strong, trustworthy, discreet, and proud. I would say all those are true. Nobody's lying here. All right, so I gotta hurry. I've only got another minute. As your crazy friend from Canada, I will not go into how long we've been friends because I just can't remember. And we already tried to talk about this and you can't remember. Yes, it's been that long. We met through an old boyfriend, let's just say. Mervyn has been forever my go-to friend, even through without social media. We both remarried. He had more kids, but I had the pleasure of listening to him with so many great stories and also sad stories with his family and friends. And I felt pretty lucky, lucky moi. I worried about his health issues and he was such a trooper through it all. Thank you, Nurse Paula, by the way. Then it was my turn and he worried about me. More crazy stuff. But lucky me again, lucky moi. I come from a family of 10 kids, and so always there's a lot of laughter and crazy stuff going on. And Merv was always privy to my good, the bad, and the ugly of anything that goes on in families and life, and always managed to find goodness in anything. He made me laugh. I made him laugh. He made me laugh. So he's a great friend. I you know what, Merv? I just love who you are. And I thank my lucky stars every day. And I'm always saying lucky moi. By the way, Mervyn and Paula, I was a good girl, did not swear. I am not wearing a mask, but I did not swear. And still not sure what to wear, so I wore pink. And so happy Easter. I was gonna say happy Easter, oh my God. Happy birthday, Mervyn. You are such a cool, sweet friend. Oh, and by the way, Linda, I'm finding you helping your kids during this long pandemic and turning your place around and turning it into a kiddo place, a kiddo pad, actually. I love what you're doing for them and I love what you're doing for your family. And you know what? It just makes you like a rock star grandpa. Lucky them. So guys, have a great time on this crazy, crazy journey. And Mervyn, love you, monsieur. I hope I did good. Let me know. Paula, I've been a good girl. Mwah.
Honey, you know what? I heard that Merv is having a birthday this week.
Oh, that's nice. He's a good man.
Yeah, he's a good man. Mm-hmm. He's one of the outstanding mm-hmm. citizens of the church mm-hmm. and all that stuff. You know, I recall that while he was first elder, he raised a lot of money for the church. Mm. And I think he did it mostly by some kind of musical events or maybe.
Yeah, those concerts.
Those concerts
always make the church feel so good.
Yeah, do you remember back in 1999 or so? He raised so much money that he paid for the entire church budget.
Mm-hmm. Good man.
Yeah, it's good man.
I'll never forget when he jumped up in the middle of a Friday evening prayer meeting and started shouting how good he feels. I suspect the spirit hit him real hard. Then you know what? He ran out of the meeting to perform at a local club. As I recall, it was a one-man show.
You know, I think you're right, because one of the backsliders of the church sent me a secret movie tape.
You don't say.
That's right. A couple of weeks after that event, and you know, I kept it in our library, but I don't think I ever showed it to you.
Well, I'd like to see it.
Okay, hold on here. Let me get my remote control.
Mm-hmm. Wow! I feel good. I knew that I would not. I feel good. I knew that I would not. So good, so good. I got to hear. Oh, I feel nice. The sugar runs by. I feel nice. The sugar runs by. So nice.
You know he's turning 70?
70?
Mm-hmm.
Are you sure? Nobody's going to believe his frail body is as young as 70. To protect his ego, he should tell folks he's turning 98. Then folks will take a guess at his age and say, you look as young as 80.
Hmm. When I told him his hearing is gone, his eyesight dimmer than a bat without solar, his gait is wobbly. You know what that storytelling optimist told me? He said, my hearing and eyesight is gone, but at least I can still drive. And he took off in that red convertible he bought during his midlife crisis. You remember that red convertible?
Yeah.
Mercy, he took off on the wrong side of the road.
My goodness, holy cow. I really think he doesn't have it any longer. You know he's turning 70.
He's turning 70?
Yeah.
Well, or so.
I tell you, I just don't think he has it anymore. What do you think?
I think he's poor soul. And let's go by his house. Let's get dressed and go by his house and see how he's making out.
Okay. Yeah, let's do that.
Okay, I'm going to get dressed. Ugh. I'm going to put on my best. You know how he likes to dress, and I want to look good. Where's my cane? Oh,
I'll man. Help you. I'll be your cane.
Oh. Oof.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh. Come on, man. Oh, come on.
I'm coming. I'm coming. You know how long it took me to get dressed? Because, you know, Merv is always looking real sharp.
Yeah, he's always on time.
And so I wanted to be sure. I look good, don't I?
You sure do.
Woo.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah. He's going to like that.
You think so?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, I called him. So he should be right coming to the door right now.
What's taking him so long? He's usually right on time to the door.
Well.
All right, let me take a look in there.
Holy cow!
What is he doing?
Mercy.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm here on behalf of my wife, Lorraine. I'm Pastor Kingsley Palmer. And Sister Paula, you asked me to do this, to celebrate your husband's birthday. 70 is the claim. You know, in fact, I've just finished this, the last pill in this bottle of my Nerve for Merv medication. You see, it's empty. So I'm gonna do my best. You said that he claims that he's 70. But every time I think of the two words, two letters, BC, I wonder if it meant before Christ or birth certificate. Please go down or Google Port of Spain and find out if there is a birth certificate, because I can't believe it. He looks very, very good. He's holding up very, very well considering, but I don't know which 70 and in what century he's actually celebrating this. Really? Anyway, young man, sir, I hope you enjoy your 70 birthday for whatever century it is. And I wish you a whole lot more. 70, give me a break. Enjoy it. Don't do too much. God bless. Enjoy your day. Bye.
That's not where I am. Hey! How are you all? All of you people who are in Toronto, don't fret. I am not the duppy of Rob Ford. I am, in fact, Tony Hendricks, as it says down there. I am Jamaican, which I know comes as a surprise to certain people. Not necessarily, maybe you may have seen some pale-faced Jamaicans before if you're amongst this group of people. But I always have to tell people, especially in America, if you think I am white, it's merely a pigment of your imagination. No, I am mixed. I am Jamaican, but I am also English, African, French, Dutch, Jewish, Christian, Indian, Hindu. I'm an Anglo, Afro, Franco, Duco, Christo, Judo, Hindu, Hindu. Out of many, one pale face. Like many of us here from the Caribbean and other parts of the world as well. And clearly, as we can see from this lovely crowd, this great array of people of different colors and classes and countries and everything, we all just love to mix and to mingle. And I think that is great. But you have to be careful, obviously, because if I went to Washington, D.C. this last week, if the police saw me, they would think he's a protester. If they saw my birth certificate, they think he's a terrorist. So you have to be careful what you let people see. Now, there are parts, even in America, I was doing a show recently in Fort Lauderdale, which in Jamaica, we call Fort Lauderdale Little Jamaica. We give it a Jamaican zip code. But even while there were people who didn't understand the whole mix of people that we have in the Caribbean, and certainly not in Jamaica, which was strange. I'm doing a show talking about Jamaica and Jamaican culture, and a man jumps up and says, "Oh, you ain't Jamaican?" I said, "Yes, man, yes, I am." "No, you ain't." I said, "Yes, my brother, I am." "No, you ain't. How come all the Jamaicans I know are black, and they all got dreadlocks, and they can all sing? If you really are Jamaican, sing a song in reggae, like it's a foreign language." Well, as any of us who are here, who are Jamaicans and Trinis and people from other parts of the world know, when our integrity is questioned, we get Bex. And when we get Bex, we get Bringle. And then all of a sudden, our true Jamaicanness kind of bubbles up like a Le Soufriere volcano until it erupts. And I look at the man and I say, "Hey, oh, who are you? You come over here, sir, and ask who I am and where I come from. You not come over there, sir, and ask who you are, whether you come over here in a Mayflower, whether you're English or African or whether you're French or Dutch, just because you know a man who take a shotgun and hang it in the rack at the back of him pickup truck. Me no man in Jamaica take machete to picking teeth. Uno move and go. And he said, hey, that's real good. Sing another one. Ay, dear. I tell you. Something. It really is. But we're here to celebrate this magnificent gentleman from all of the wonderful eulogizing and the tributes and everything by people who have known you far longer than I have, which is about, since 5 o'clock your time. In fact, people have been questioning whether Merv is 70 years old. Well, I think by the time this Zoom birthday party is finished, he'll be at least 72. But apart from that, you do look, I have to say, because Paula sent me a video so that I knew what you looked like. And I have to say, you epitomize the term black no crack. That is for sure. And it's something that we can all appreciate if we have a mix and a little touch of melanin, you know, like brown, stick around, you know, and red, don't get aged. So congratulations on keeping fit and very good shape. That's all good to know. Now, I did a little bit of research, and apart from your magnificent church background and your involvement, and you've touched on many people's lives, obviously, you are a real estate agent, I believe. You said, I have been told by people, you are one of the greatest salesmen that they have ever met. And that's fantastic and to be applauded. And Paula, of course, you have been married to Paula for 34 years, and she still wears that wedding ring that you sold her. Excellent salesman. You met in the church, which is fantastic. I mean, Paula, as a Jamaican woman, would have been told by her mother and by her grandmother, meet a man in the church. Because even if he turns out to be a worthless old dog, at least him go to church. That's always a good place to start. And Merv, we know you're a hard worker because you as a Trinidadian married a Jamaican woman. That we all know is exceptionally hard work. Not least of all because, you know, if you talk to a Trini woman, if a man tries to give lyrics to a Trini woman, you say, boy, you look good. And the Trini woman will say, thanks. You give lyrics to a Jamaican woman and say, boy, you look good. She says, what you want? Eh? You think I don't know? Yes. A good thing you go to church. Pray. That's better. And of course, the Jamaicans and Trinis, we are similar, but we are also different as well. We have different things that we do. The language, the Jamaican language, is very unique. And of course, you've had to work hard to understand Jamaicans. I'm sure members of Paula's Jamaican family, you know, Jamaica is the only country I know you can have a complete conversation using just the vowels. Eh? Eh? I? Oh, you. And we count differently. We count differently in Jamaica. In America, you count 1, 2, 3, long division, multiplication, decimal point. In Jamaica, we count 1, 2, couple, few, holy, enough and plenty. And our body language is different. Everybody knows in Jamaica, we are the only people who can give directions by pointing with our lips. Where's the restroom? You can be stabbed in the back by somebody's lips in Jamaica. Who's that troublemaker? That's how we stay. And the differences and the similarities don't stop there. Down in Trinidad, you have carnival. In Jamaica, we have carnage. Down in Trinidad, you have road march. Oh, in Jamaica, we are roadblock. Down in Trinidad, you get something and wave. In Jamaica, we get something and fling it at you. That's right. But then there is one magnificent thing that we do, and we do it differently. In Trinidad, you take an oil drum and you slice it in two and you beat it out and you make sweet pan music. In Jamaica, we take the same oil drum, we slice it the other way, and we cook sweet jerk chicken. If music be the food of love, play on. And I think one of the difficulties, obviously, when you come from especially a Caribbean background and a mixed background, living in the United States or England or Canada as well, you know, you don't want your people to show you up. You don't, you know. I hear talking to Paula, but also listening to you, you both have your accents from your countries of origin, and that's fantastic, you know. But you don't want your people to show you up. And it's tough sometimes watching the news, you know, when they say there has been a robbery and you're going, please, don't make it black people. You know how that is. And worse, when they get into certain crimes, you start. I was reading the newspaper the other day and there was a headline. It said, customs officer caught and charged for 30 years worth of smuggling. And I'm thinking, please, no, don't. And I look in the picture and the man is black. And I'm thinking, hopefully, I don't know. And then I started to read down and it said he had made a lot of money over the 30 years. He bought himself a house, and he had bought himself a BMW for himself and his wife. I said, that don't look good. He had bought jewelry for himself and his wife. I thought, that don't good. And it said he built a house in his hometown of Port of Spain, Trinidad. And I said, you're rich, you? Thank goodness it wasn't Jamaican. That's all I can say. And you know, it can be very, very tough, you know, in the States. No, in Jamaica, and I don't know if this is something that you did when you were in Trinidad, but in Jamaica, a lot of people like to go to bird bus, to shoot birds and stuff. That's something that, you know, many of us have done in Jamaica. And a friend of mine, he was retiring, and a group of us got together, and we got licenses to shoot birds in every single state of the United States of America, because we know he loved to go to bird bush. I said, where do you want to go? He said, I want to go to Louisiana. I said, you mad? He said, no, I want to go out into the bayou and shoot duck. I said, no, man. All right. And a group of us went, and we drive into the bayou. And when we go into the bush, we start shooting. There was duck-like sand. It was fantastic shooting. And I, at one point, I had some of the extra strings of duck. And I said, well, I'll take them back to the SUV that we hired. So I was taking them back. And I happened to have the bag with the licenses, the bird shooting licenses in. And when I get back to the SUV, there is a man there with a big red neck and a name tag. I said, uh-oh, this is not going to go well at all. And he looked at me and he said, what you got there, boy? I said, well, I have some duck. He said, you need a license to shoot duck in this here state of Louisiana. I said, well, that's all right. I have a Louisiana license. And I went into the bag and I pulled out the Louisiana license and I give it to him. He said, give me one of them duck. So I give him the duck. He took his finger and he put it under the duck's wing like this. And he rub it up and down and he go, this ain't no Louisiana duck. I said, what? Well, you can't tell this. I know this ain't no Louisiana duck. This here's a Texas duck, and you ain't got a license to shoot no Texas duck. So I say yes, and I give him the Texas license. You say, give me another duck. So I give him another duck and take him finger, rub it under the duck's wing. This here ain't no Louisiana or Texas duck. This here's an Arkansas duck, and you ain't got no license to shoot no Arkansas duck. I say, yes, man, I'll give him the Arkansas license. He said, give me another duck. So I give him another duck. He said, I'm going to fix you this time, boy. And rub his finger underneath the duck's wing. You out of luck this time, boy. This here's an Alaska duck, and you sure as heck ain't got no license to shoot no Alaska duck. I say, yeah, man. And I give him the Alaska license. He said, boy, you got a license to shoot duck in every state of the United States of America. Where the heck are you from? I said, you know something? You're the expert. Why you don't tell me? Now, I think one of the best things about being on Zoom is that you can take a drink and you don't have to drive home. That's fantastic, because that's it's the whole thing that we have seen over this last year, really, and from a long time before that, is the way that police treat people in the United States, especially. And it's very different. It's very different in Jamaica, you know. I mean, here, if you're driving along and you see the blue light flashing, you know, you think, all right, I have my license, I have my insurance, and I have my my tags are all up. Yeah, everything cool. In Jamaica, when you see the police blue light, you think, I have my wallet? Yes, we're good. Because they have speed guns in this country that will tell you how fast you're going. In Jamaica, they tell you how much you have to pay. So, you know, if you get stopped by a policeman in Jamaica, you say, you know how fast you was going? Say about $3,000, officer. No, man, you were going about $10,000. And the drinking and driving can be a problem sometimes in the Caribbean. And I actually got stopped by the police the other day in Jamaica, and they stepped out into the middle of the road and they said, pull over. So I pulled over. He said, why were you overtaking the truck on the railway line? I said, because nobody coming the other way flashed their headlights to tell me that you were here, officer. My salvation came in the shape of a man who had been drinking so much, we could smell him from 150 yards away as he was driving down the road. Could smell the white rum. The young policeman stood out in the road. Would you please pull over to the side of the road, sir?
Not at all.
It's where it is. Over there, sir. Oh, that one. All right. Hold on, sir. Hold on. Can I see your license, please? I hope so, because I can't see nothing. Sir, have you been drinking? I hope so. Otherwise, it's something me eat. Sir, is this where you live?
Here? No, man. I live up the hill.
You? No. Do you live at Murray Close?
You live at Murray Close? That's great.
Sir, do you have insurance?
Whoa, you're the second person today try to sell me some of that.
No, for your car.
I beg your pardon?
For your car.
Of course, for my car. Who for car you think it is? You think the thief it?
Sir, I'm going to have to ask you to blow into a bag.
Why? What happened? Your patty too hot?
No, sir. It's a breathalyzer. You blow into the bag, it tell you how much alcohol you have inside you.
I don't need to blow in a bag to tell you how much alcohol I have inside me. I've a whole bag at home will tell me that when we reach.
Sir, I'm going to have to ask you to accompany me to the station. And I warn you, anything that you say may be written down and used in a court of law against you.
I think somebody should write something down, because I'm not going to remember none of this tomorrow. But why are we going to the police station? That's where I was going.
How you mean, sir?
I've been trying to tell you I am Chief Inspector Murray of the Mobile Traffic Division.
Mervyn, have a blessed and wonderful birthday, and blessings and love to everybody there, and definitely, especially Paula, who I've met as well. So God bless. Thank you.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, that was great. Great presentation. So we're back, okay? I'm back to the point that I was trying to make. I've got to convince you. You've heard the powerful testimony. You've heard about my father and my grandfather and their relationship. You've heard the great pastor, is it Pastor Gabriel? You've heard him. I think he's on board. He is skeptical that Merv is really 70. Pastor Palmer, he was right. His question was, really? Is Merv really 70? He's not convinced either. I think he's in my corner. Pastor Cassimi is doubtful. All the pastors are on my side, but there are some skeptics. Still some skeptics that are out there. I got a call from someone in Ormond Beach, Florida. He's a skeptic skeptic. He doesn't believe. He doesn't believe a thing I say to him. I don't know whether he really believes Merv is 70 or not. But I think I want to try to convince the skeptic from Ormond Beach. I've got another document, ladies and gentlemen. This one here, I submit to you, will convince even the skeptic amongst you that Merv is not 70. Please take a look at this next slide. Ladies and gentlemen, in case you didn't realize, that's Merv on the right. He was there. Merv was actually there. I rest my case. What else do I need to show you? He brought gifts of frankincense and myrrh. He was there at the birth. MGW is not 70. Based on this evidence, uncontroverted, Merv George Williams is at least 2,000 years of age, ladies and gentlemen. Pastor Gabriel is right. Trust me, I'm a lawyer and we don't lie. Trust me, ladies and gentlemen. Merv and Paula are trying to perpetrate a fraud. They believe in conspiracy theories and they believe in falsehood. Trust me, ladies and gentlemen, I'm a lawyer and we don't lie. We'll continue now with the next segment of our program. But bear in mind, I think there may be still some skeptics among you, and I've got one other document that I want to show you before I make my closing arguments. I will convince you before it's all done that Merv G. Williams is not 70. The next part of our program will be a presentation, a musical presentation. And after that, we'll have an open mic session with several individuals who've already been selected, who will offer words regarding their perspective about Merv G. Williams. And then I'll come back to you and make my point one last time. Let's continue with the program.
Wow, listening to everyone share how Merv and Paula have impacted their lives really inspires us. We are grateful to even know Merv and Paula. Well, Merv, it feels like you and Paula have been in our lives for longer than just a few years. When we mustered up the courage to ask you to be our manager for our music ministry, we had no idea that you and Paula would become our family. Your attention to detail and determination for excellence resonates in everything that you do. Your faith in God is demonstrated through the calm peace that you maintain, no matter what the circumstances may be. And you keep your word, and you aren't afraid to correct something. Admonitions always spoken in love. And your dedication to communication and your beloved Bluetooth never ceases, even in the midst of the giant redwoods as the rest of us are admiring the view. Sam, Dan, and I are blessed to know you and to call you family. Princeton is blessed to know you as Grandpa. May you continue to allow the Lord to bless others through you, as we have seen evidence of this all throughout this evening. May your light shine bright, and we look forward to learning more wisdom from you and Paula. On behalf of myself, my husband Sam, Dan, and Princeton, and the Cheese and Music team, we wish you a very happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Merv. 310. What an accomplishment. Not out, I might add. With all evidence pointing to you heading straight on to make that century and beyond. I'm so happy to be considered a friend of yours, Merv. I still remember the very first conversation we had. Seems like yesterday, but it's hard to imagine that it was heading on 10 years now. You know, we were introduced by a mutual friend, you know, Clive Cassamy, and our friendship just blossomed from that point forward. I remember you calling and saying, hey, you know, this is just a quick call. Well, I'm sure all of your friends know, Merv, that there's no such thing as a quick call with Merv Williams. You know, you have to set aside at least 2 to 3 hours, you know, to be sure that you can get all of your points in with him, you know. Merv, you've been an astonishing friend to me. What a personality you are. What an inspiration. I've learned so much from you. You've been there for me and with me through thick and thin. Sometimes I feel pretty selfish because I know I pick up the phone so often and call you to get your advice on this or that, and you're always so willing to do it and to share, you know, even some of your issues to help me through. Merv, thank you so much for your friendship. Thank you for the inspiration that you are to me. And I was surely hoping that it would have been possible for us to all get together this year where I could meet some of the other wonderful people that you have in your life. But we'll have to just plan to get this done next year. But thank you so much for your friendship. Have a happy birthday. Love you. And I really hope that we can get together soon. Take care, my friend. Happy birthday again.
Pan music and lots of food and, oh my goodness, I think we need to get ready to go. Huh? I think we need to get ready to go. Happy birthday, Merv.
So at this time, we're going to have an open mic segment. There are some individuals who've been chosen. You know the order that you're supposed to appear. Take it over.
what's up? Listen, it's all Sam. Just what he wants me to do. Just, is he ready? Okay. All right. Next. Okay.
Birthday, Merv. Well, Merv, there's one other person who didn't want to miss out on their chance to wish you a happy birthday. Are you ready, Princeton? You ready to wave? Here, let me help you. Happy birthday, Grandpa. We love you very much. Yay!
I know why you're all here. Most likely it's the same reason why I'm here. And that's to get the real dirt on my dad. And you know what? So far, I'm a little disappointed. All we've heard is what a great friend he is and how he's the go-to person for advice. Where's the drama? Where's the crack in his armor? First of all, my dad left Trinidad more than 50 years ago, and yet his internal clock is still set to island time. So if you want to be anywhere on time, you better tell him 30 minutes before you need to be there, or else you're going to be late. Second, my dad has 4 children and 6 grandchildren and counting. And I swear I've been called every name but my own. Nadine, Steph, Quinn, look, which one are you? I say, Dad, just refer to me as your favorite child. You know, with these older folks, you got to remind them, or else they'll forget. Last but not least, his pronunciation. He says vehicle. I say, Dad, what's with the emphasis on the H? It's vehicle. He says vegetable. I say, Dad, it's vegetable. I could go on and on, but I got a limited time slot. All jokes aside, on behalf of my brother Quentin and I want to wish our father a happy birthday and many more to come. One of my favorite things to do with my dad is to watch action flicks, because without fail, whenever someone does a good maneuver in a fight, he always says, that was a good move. Well, Daddy, turning 70, that was a good move. I love you. Happy birthday.
I have to skip the open mic.
So what I'm going to do now is ask each of you to unmute your mics as we get ready to sing Happy Birthday to Merv. Please unmute your mics and we'll start by singing Happy Birthday to Merv. Now, normally I would lead in the singing, but I've got a sore throat today. So can someone help me out?
Nice try, Dan. Nice try.
Anybody ready?
Okay. Ready? Alan?
Yes.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, let's get ready to start.
Ready?
Stuck with me.
One.
Are you ready? Three.
Happy birthday from Toronto, Merv. It's Blanche.
Happy birthday from the Bahamas.
We from Florida.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, can you hear me?
Happy birthday, Merv.
We can hear you.
Yes, we can hear you.
Not with that lady.
Okay, the last segment. I've got one more piece of evidence to show. Still trying to convince you. The pastors have agreed. I think I've made a pretty credible and powerful argument. I've shown you the historical documents.
This will be written in the picture of the nativity scene. And then with his kids.
Most of you are convinced by my arguments, I think.
We have to learn about, President.
But there's one skeptic. He still is. He's always a skeptic. It's a gentleman from Ormond Beach. I have a way to convince him. The truth is, I'll give you some background about Merv.
Look at him.
Most of you don't know this, but Merv is a skilled tradesman. I lived in Maryland, and Merv helped me finish the basement of my house. I didn't know that he was that skilled, but I didn't know that he was an avid sailor.
There
the next picture that I have, I think.
That's the one I was talking about.
Demonstrate Merv's two passions, one for sailing and the second for carpentry. Most importantly, ladies and gentlemen, most importantly, I think the next photograph will convince even the greatest skeptic.
You are elected official. You are
the argument that I've been trying to make. All of you will be convinced after my next presentation.
Which theater?
That Merv is not seven.
Yeah. West Virginia.
He is not even 500 years old.
The police that
he's older than 2000.
Some of them didn't want to show in their badge.
Ladies and gentlemen,
the next police badge. So they probably thought it was, you know what I'm saying?
You, ladies and gentlemen, Merv has been lying to you. And Paula has been enabling him. Please take a look at the next slide. And by the way, please mute your mics, please. The next slide. Ladies and gentlemen, this is it. Merv the carpenter, getting ready to set sail on his maiden voyage. He was there with Noah performing skilled labor. Ladies and gentlemen, Merv is at least 6,000 years old. There's a reason why he looks the same as he's always looked. I understand that you cannot have a crack on your face, but Merv looks like a baby. Has anybody ever tried to hold or touch Merv's hand? That's not an earthly set of hands. Those hands are historical. Those are hands of somebody who works as a realtor. But believe it or not, he's a carpenter. He has extraordinary skills. But the bottom line is, ladies and gentlemen, Merv G. Williams is at least 6,000 years old. Trust me. Trust me. I'm a lawyer, and we don't lie. Okay, the next part of our program is going to feature the birthday boy himself, Merv G. Williams. Please pay attention as he speaks to you now. Let's turn the mic over to Merv, please. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Good evening. I'm a little intoxicated from all of the strong, potent stuff that the Masters of Ceremony has been giving us today. I am delighted to see that many of you have not bought into this Kool-Aid that he is sharing for us to drink and become drunken with information that we cannot rationalize truth from fiction. You know, what is interesting too is that he is roping others in there with him. And by doing that, you're becoming complicit if you started to agree with him. Somebody sitting right here next to me and started to repeat some of the things Earl were saying. So you got to be careful what you fall for. But I want to let you know how grateful I am for you taking the time out of your schedule to spend this time this evening. Over the last couple of months, and particularly within the last week, I heard the phrase repeated, I can't say many times, a few times, because if I said many times, then I would be letting you know what I was doing over the last couple of weeks. And that is, Paula would consistently say to me, stay out of it. Because it's so hard. I see Kim laughing. She knows what I'm talking about. It is so hard to have something being planned and you don't know the details, because somewhere in the details there's something, some little nugget that you could fix. And I keep getting stay out of it. I have another friend, Jackie, she spoke. She said, you just can't help yourself, can you? And I guess I can't, but I really want to let you know how much I appreciate all of the things that you guys shared this evening. And I'm going to pray especially for some of you who have shared some of the things that you shared. And I know after tonight, you'll be put back in a better place, because Earl have a way of convincing people on these things. But I really want to let you know I appreciate it. I want to particularly thank Paula for putting this all together, and I call them her co-conspirators. I love you too, Kim. I call them the co-conspirators, you know, where nobody wants to say anything. I called the secretary at church, Sherry, and I said, I'm just trying to figure out what's going on here. She said, don't ask me. You're not going to get anything out of me. So nobody had a soft spot that I could really penetrate. And all of this stuff is going on. Sam, Cheeser, and Jessica, they dedicate so much of their time to help with the technology part of it here. And of course, with their music, it's just incredible. They sing at churches and meetings and for the conference and the union. We appreciate that. And if you have a need for a good group, sure, give me a call, invite them to your church. Hopefully when COVID is over, we can make an in-person appearance, but definitely we could do it by Zoom as well. So don't hesitate to do that. So we want to thank them. I also want to thank those of you who went on and made a donation to the Make-A-Wish Foundation on behalf of my belated grandson and what he experienced and the generosity of Make-A-Wish Foundation, who help kids that are in critical conditions in their health, help them to get one of their dreams realized. And they were very, very helpful to our family. We want to be appreciative of that. And again, because some of you inquired about what to get for Merv, if you wanted to go on the site, it's on the invitation that you got. It's the very first invitation that you got. There are several announcements, but go to the first one and you can click on that. It takes you directly to the donation page. And if you're so inclined, make a donation. It's a tax deductible donation and it will help some other kid. I always try to take advantage of an audience that I have when there are men in the audience. Many of you know that I'm a prostate cancer survivor and I'm an advocate. I encourage men to get screened annually because the early detection is the best action you can take for prostate cancer. Discovering it early gives you the best chance of survival. And I can testify to that. One very quick thing that happened within the last few months, one morning, my wife said to me, you know, you were sleeping and I counted for 27 seconds where you weren't breathing. And I said, oh? And then she made that observation over time and suggested that maybe we go see the doctor and have a sleep apnea test. I did that. Now, I didn't know anything about sleep apnea. Many of you may be experiencing it or have experienced it, but many of you don't know that you're experiencing it. But if somebody who is familiar with medical issues, they may observe that you lie at night and you sleep in your bed and you're not breathing for long periods of time, and it could be really the difference between life and death. So if you feel that you're having these issues, not only that, but if you're at the age that my contemporaries are, just go and have a sleep test done and just get an indication of what is going on, if at all you have that issue. And that will help you. So those are the two things that I take on as a passion. And I want to really, really thank again everybody who has been instrumental in making this evening what it is. And I appreciate your comments. And I look forward to seeing you guys when you get to this age. Somebody said you guys are 5 years behind. According to Earl's math and Gart's matriculation that caused him to understand these things, he seemed to think that you guys are maybe 100 years behind. I don't know. But you got to watch these guys. You know, you got to watch what they say. Don't believe everything you hear. And lawyers, yeah, they're great friends. But, you know, lawyers are lawyers. Yeah. And some of them are at the head of the line. Some of them are even judges. Well, I thank you all very much. I know I wanted to share something with you. When I'm walking around the house, if a funny sound is made or something is knocked over, you know, Paula wants to inquire, well, what happened? What is it? You know, did you walk into something? Did you hit something? Did you knock something? For some reason, the air seemed to go up because she doesn't know how a 70-year-old is supposed to act, I guess. So this is what she's running into. And, you know, the other day she said to me, be careful. Don't hit your foot against the dresser, as a lot of us do at night. Or don't hit your foot against the edge of the bed. Suddenly you realize that the dresser has grown. It's gotten bigger than the space you usually walk by. The door is really smaller. You bonk your shoulder. You know, things like that, you know. And then she always wants to hear, when she hears a song, she wants to know what it is that caused that sound. Well, the other day I went to the bathroom. She said, what are you going to do? I said, well, you have to stop somewhere. I went to the doctor recently, and he had some solid advice for me. He said, you have got to be careful, because when you get older, you fall. And look at the recommendation. Watch for yourself and see the recommendation. Sam, this is the recommendation he gave me. Well, yeah, and what I do is I always try to listen to the doctor, because that's how you catch things early, when you listen to the doctor. And he had some very solid recommendation for me, because he didn't want me to experience broken bones and limbs. Let me know when you're ready. Well. Well, it looks like I have to pass up on that one. So, in addition to that, over the years I've had some experiences, and people have been very, very good to me, and I've enjoyed every decade of my life. And if you can't get the previous slide, I'm going to run some slides for you now and let you know how I feel, and the praise and thanks that I want to give God for the health he's given me, and the people around me who has made my life possible and, you know, contribute to my lack of stress, because they understand how I function, and they respond to that. So this is the advice my doctor gave me. So I totally misunderstood what he meant. So that's what the result of what he said turned out to be. So I had to go back to him and tell him I'm falling down more than I did before I took his advice. So I have to be very careful. But anyway, let me share this with you with the next set of thank you to everybody who's been involved in my life. And here are some of the people who make a difference to me as well. And I wanted to share that with you.
Say thanks for all the things you have done for me, things so undeserved, yet you gave to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be, I owe it all to thee. To God the glory, to God for the things he has done. With his blood he has saved me. With his power he has raised me. Let it be pleasing, Lord, to thee. And should I gain any praise, let it go to Calvary. Calvary.
You got a problem, Lenore? Are those chitlins?
Is that Homer?
Who's Homer?
Of course it is.
What are you up to? How was your Sabbath?
It was great. How, does Leonore and Billy hear, do they hear us?
No, they look like they didn't hear me.
I think he's saying yes.
Why are we on there still?
There we are.
Is it over?
I don't know. Lord, goodness,
people are still on the Zoom.
They had their food delivered.
Difficulties. And we are going into closing prayer. Thank you so much for joining
us. I can hear real faint.
It's been a someone
pleasure.
Real faint.
Yeah. See all the friends and that's family not the door. Merv throughout the decades, centuries. I mean decades. Yeah. And we are going to close in prayer. Let us bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessings that you give us every day in family and friendship. We thank you for the many years that you have given Merv so that he can be a blessing to others. We thank you that you have put it in his heart to dedicate his life in service to you and as a result to all of us. And I pray that we will also continue this blessing to other people so that others will be blessed as well. We pray that you will carry us through this year, please, a special blessing over the Williams family. And Lord, please keep us safe in 2021. And may we share your love with everyone we meet. We pray this in your holy name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
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 Hi, Earl.
Are you the Duke of Earl?
You can't hear.
Is that good or bad?
Ladies and gentlemen, that's it for tonight. Thank you very much for participating. Thank you much for spending this much time with us. We love you. The Williams, thank you. And Merv, thanks you. Have a good evening. Thank you.
Lawyer.
Bye, Earl. Take
good
care.
Night.
Happy birthday.
Birthday. Goodbye.
Happy birthday.
Good night. Happy birthday. Enjoy the rest of the evening.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday,
happy birthday,
Mervyn.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy
birthday. Happy birthday. Happy
birthday. Enjoyed it.
Well,
all right.
Just go toast.
Hey, good to see you, Billy and Lenore.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Merv. From Gia and Earl and all the kids. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Merv.
Happy birthday, Merv.
Happy birthday, Merv, from Uncle Wilfred.
Thank you, Trish.
Happy birthday, Merv, from all of us, from Dexter, Derek, Nyasha, Simone, Gia, and myself. All the best and all the grandchildren, man.
Best of wishes, Merv, for the last year. Good to see you.
Oh, happy birthday.
Good wishes, from the
to where Jesus is, where Jesus is. Anybody take me to where Jesus is? Can anybody take me to where Jesus is? Where Jesus is? Can anybody take me to where Jesus is?
I've heard that he can heal a broken heart.
Take me to where he is.
He can put back a life that's been torn apart.
Jesus,
I wanna go.
Can anybody take me
to where?
To where
Jesus, now get
I like that song.
Oh, yes.
Hi, Amethy. Oh,
hello, who is it? Hi, Pastor Casimir.
Yes, I was rolling with